Hey everybody, my name is Angie Murenga. You're watching Just Angie. It's another Thursday and we're having this amazing, very encouraging, very uplifting conversation with Olyvia. Wow.
Yes.
So you have your visa?
So I have my visa and I went on my scheduled date.
Wow.
And I was like, wow, this is God. This is all God. And it was so exciting. It was my first time to go to the States and I was like, wow, this is a fun adventure. And we're going for a whole month. So I was like, I don't even know what this month holds, but let's see what God has. And one of the things that I really wanted to do was to find a Bible school. Because I remembered Houston, Texas, we need to look for that Bible school.
Wow.
Yes. So I went, when I got there, I just went on holiday mode. Now I wasn't even thinking about school anymore. I was just taking it all in, enjoying the different things that America has to offer. I got to visit different states. Like, it was really nice. And my uncle kept asking me, what about school? Because he's so big on school. So he's like, we need to look for schools. You need to go see what different schools have to offer. And I was like, yeah. But I wasn't feeling that conviction to do anything about it. And so 1 week goes by, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and then our last week. I haven't done anything. The last weekend of us being there. And one of my mom's friends was like, you guys haven't visited our church, you should come. And we're like, oh yeah, we've gone to different churches the whole time. So yeah, let's go see on our last Sunday. And she mentions, by the way, we have a very big Bible school that our church runs.
No.
And she just said it for the sake of saying, she didn't know I was looking for a Bible school or anything. She just said it and then moved on to other stories. But I picked it and I was like, Bible school. So I asked her, what's the name of your church? And she told me, and I was like, okay, I'm going to check out their website, see what their Bible school is called. And I'm going to know everything about it before we go tomorrow so that I can know what questions to ask. That night, I was up the whole night just looking through what they had to offer. And it was basically what I'd been asking God for.
Wow, Olivia.
And I was like, what?
This is crazy.
And then it was so affordable.
You
like, it was
be
the
serious.
First affordable school I found. And I was like, okay, this is almost too good to be
to
true.
To be true.
So I was like, okay, it's good. We're going to the church tomorrow so we can know if the doctrine is sound. And then mom is with me, so she'll be able to tell me if she feels like anything is off. So I was like, okay, this is good. Let me not get too excited. And so we go to church the next day. And it was wonderful. It actually felt like my church here at home, just Americanized. And I was like, this is really nice. And mom loved it as well. She was like, this is a really nice place.
Wow.
Like, this actually might be where you'll come. And I'm like, okay, let's wait and see. So after service, one of our friends came and told us, come, let's go. You need to meet the dean of the school. And so I was like, oh, that's good, I can ask a few questions. So I got to meet the dean, and then I was taken to meet the lead pastors, and I got to ask all these questions and to understand what this school is about. And I was like, this sounds good, I think I'll apply. And they told me, yeah, just go on here and apply and let's see. And I was like, wow. And they're really big. They were really big on taking in international students. And so they were so excited. They're like, you're from Kenya. We haven't had a Kenyan in so many years. You should come. And I was getting so excited. I was like, okay, I'll apply. So the next week we come back home. And again, I'm like, okay, I don't really feel like applying. But I'm excited, but I should apply. So one of my friends sat me down one day and she was like, you're applying right now. And I was like, okay, fine.
Well done.
Yeah, so I started the process. And then halfway through, I was like, these questions are so complicated. I don't know. I'll just wait and I'll do it another time. And then the school reached out to me. And they're like, hey, Olivia, we see you have an application that you began to fill in. If you need any help, let us know. And so I was like, wow. Okay.
Okay.
So that was October when I came back. Yeah, I think it was end of October, and the next intake was in January, and I was like, that's a bit soon, but you know what? Yeah, let me apply. Meanwhile, before I left for the States, God had told me, resign from your job, and I was like, resign? Why? But I was like, you know what? I'm just gonna obey.
So you resigned before you left?
So I resigned before I left. And I gave my 1 month's notice, which was my 1 month's leave. And I wasn't sure that they would accept that, but they were like, okay, fine. And so in my head, I was like, if God has had me resign, then definitely I'm going to school in January. And then as I continued to apply, they told me, unfortunately, we're not accepting international students in the spring semester. You have to wait for the fall, which was the next year, October.
Oh my gosh.
And I was like, that doesn't make sense. I've just quit my job. What? Again, now I was taken aback and I was like, Lord, what does this mean? What am I doing for almost a year? Okay. And so I didn't even want to talk about it anymore. I was like, you know what? We'll just put the school thing on hold and let's just see where God takes me. And so the next year, as we were beginning January, I had nothing. I wasn't working. And I was like, what's the plan, Lord? And in that season, while I was still trying to figure out what God is doing, I met my now husband.
What?
Yes, we have been friends for many years since high school. We met when I was 15 and he was 17. And he always loved me and he always knew, you know what, you're going to be my wife. When he was 17, he was telling me, you're going to be my wife. And I was like, I don't even know what I'm going to study in uni. How will I know who my husband is? Oh my gosh. And so years later, we meet again and start talking. And even before I left for the States, we would text a lot, but we weren't hanging out or anything, so I didn't think anything of it. But in January, he lost his sister, and I felt so burdened. I was like, I need to be there for him. I just feel like I need to be there for him. And so we began to hang out, and I was encouraging him and just being there for him. And in the midst of that, we formed a friendship.
Wow.
And the rest of that year, things began to progress, and I began to see, this is actually who I've been praying for. I just didn't realize it. And for him, he was always like, you know what, Olivia, you're going to get married to a businessman. And I was like, nope, I'm getting married to someone like me, someone in ministry. In fact, he's probably a pastor.
Nope.
Yeah, I had this whole image of who I wanted. And so I think that's why I kind of wrote him off. I was like, he's in business, he's not in ministry. Yeah, I mean, he's a good Christian man, but he's good for someone else, not me.
And you know, that's exactly what I feel, because even I feel like that for myself. And I always wonder why. And then a visiting minister came and prophesied the same, just to confirm it. But I think it's also because of I guess maybe, I don't know whether you figured it out for yourself, but for me, I think it's the strength of who we are and also the ministry that we have. Like for the one I have, surely I was wondering, where, pastor, how are we going, what are we going? I know where I'm going, I know what I'm supposed to be doing.
Yes.
So now, you'll be coming in from where with your story? So thank God he's a businessman. He should do business and show us how we can, but still articulate sort of the expression in the marketplace, but not as a pastor.
So he would tell me, you know what, I don't feel called to go out and actually preach, but I feel like I should support. Especially financially. He's always said that, and
that
I'm like, good
so
for
true.
You, but you know,
Olivia,
not for
honestly.
Me. I know. And he would tell me, you wait and see.
Yeah.
Just wait
and
see.
I love this confidence. Yeah. You wait and see.
Just wait and see.
Yeah.
And as time went by, as I got to know him, I was like, he compliments me in so many ways. Like, I didn't realize I needed this. And so slowly, I began to see, okay, this might be him. But I was like, I have to pray. God has to rubber stamp this one. And it has to be so clear.
I'm really waiting for your rubber stamp. Because even me, I'm waiting for it has to be so clear.
Yes. And in that season, the counterfeits. The counterfeits.
That's such a good thing you brought that up. Because I don't know what, I don't know why. But every time you're going to engage with the real thing, the counterfeits chomok. You mean there were even counterfeits with?
So many.
Huh?
At that point, there were like almost, I think, 9 people who were pursuing me. And
you
I was
can't
like,
be serious.
Where have all these guys come from?
Come from all of a sudden?
Yeah.
Where have they been? Where did I really?
Exactly.
Yes.
All
but that's the enemy. And
yes.
And you know, you have to, I'd like to know how you navigated that, because you really have to be confident about what what you know and what God has called you to do. Like now for me, there are certain things that God has said that I, you know, that I know about my husband that I really must stay focused. But what were there clues? Were there things? What made you then remain focused since everything has come out of the woodwork now? All the nine jamas are here.
They're all here and they're all saying, in fact, I think three of them were very vocal, like, God has told me you're my wife. And I'm like,
what?
God can't be speaking to all of you. I mean, it's only one or even none of you.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, I need to pray. And so I prayed and fasted in that season. And I was like, Lord, just give me clarity. Let me see. And so I began to see things in some of them that I was like, no, for sure, this is not it. You're a good man, but I just know. It's like I could just see this is not gonna work. And so slowly the number reduced and then it came down to two of them.
What? Yes. Olivia, two?
Two. Oh, and I was goodness. Like,
does your husband know this? Anyway, let me just say.
He knows everything.
What? Two now?
Two. And I was
two
like,
is not good.
Okay. One of them is so funny and so much fun to be around and he's awesome and he's in ministry. Then there's Kevin, who is awesome, so loving, so caring, but he's not in ministry, but he has a heart for the things of God, but I don't know.
And he understands his role. He understands his role is to support you to go do what you need to do. But you see, that might be the carrot. The carrot for you must have been ministry.
And so I was like, okay.
Oh,
and
my
then
God.
When I looked at how I was feeling, I was like, okay, let me, where are my emotions here? How am I feeling towards these guys? I loved both of them as just my friends. I didn't see anything more in both of them. And that bothered me. I was like, okay, God, why aren't I feeling like this pool, this chemistry? Like, I don't know, there was something missing.
Mm. And do you think sometimes, do you think what was missing was sometimes we don't give ourselves the permission to feel that way?
Perhaps.
Yeah.
And when I prayed about it, God spoke so clearly that day. Mm-hmm. And he told me, love grows. It doesn't just happen.
Wow.
Love is a seed that grows. And he told me he's going to plant a seed of love in my heart for my husband. And as time goes by, it's going to grow. And I love him deeper and deeper.
You, so by the way, you're leaving in October. Are we aware? I've just remembered. I thought you're leaving in October. To compound the whole issue.
Yes. So I decided I need to pace myself. Like, I shouldn't be in a hurry to feel a whirlwind of emotion or whatever.
Olivia.
Like, okay, fine. So
too
that gave me comfort.
Too much. So much that's going on in the season. You see, there's another series. I don't know whether you watch Bishop T.D. Jakes, but he's doing one of the things that he's done to start the year is Bridges to Destiny. And he talked about the pacemaker. Pace yourself. Anyway, something about pacing yourself.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm telling you, there's nothing that is for the season, although for every season, then to pace yourself.
Yeah.
Even the word that Reverend Teresia Wairimu released on Isaiah 40 verse 31 is still a pacing yourself. Because you need to know, it says he gives strength to the weary.
Yes.
She released it for the nation. Mm-hmm. So he gives strength to the weary, but you must know when to walk. For me, my takeout, you must know when to walk and when to run.
Yes.
Because it says he will give you strength, you will soar on wings like eagle, you will walk and not grow weary, or run and not grow weary, and walk and not grow faint.
Mm-hmm.
But for me, the biggest takeout from that prophecy was, in this season, you have to know, or not even in this season, in every season, you must know when to run and when to walk, when to soar.
Yes.
So you see, all those are different elements of how I'm going to pace myself.
Mm-hmm.
So my goodness. So God said, pace yourself.
Yes. Just relax. I got you covered. And I was like, wow.
Okay. Hold that thought. We'll see you next Thursday. Bye.
Mm-hmm.